0141 951 1025. It's time to talk football. It's Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Good evening and welcome to Clyde One Super Scoreboard on another big European night for our Scottish clubs. Hearts host Rosenborg, trailing from the first leg as Hibs take their lead over to face Luzerne. There will be no Celtic fans at Ibrox for the next derby, and Celtic's new signing Gustaf Lagerbielke wants to model himself on former Hoops favourite Mark Wilson. Just kidding, it's Virgil van Dijk, but Mark is here alongside Gordon Dalziel.
Let's start. You've burst my bubble there instantly, Gordon. But a huge night again in Scottish football. Rangers getting the job done on Tuesday evening, and it's now over to Hearts and Hibs. Both games finally in the balance. Hearts have got to fancy their chances, where Lee Johnson might just think he's got a lot of work to do. It's going to be a difficult night.
Hibs are leading and Hearts are losing.
Oh, really? I know. Yeah. But I think Hearts will fancy themselves at Tynecastle, where our Hibs, I think, will be a tricky tie.
What a pessimistic outlook for the
Hibs. I thought you meant the games had already kicked off.
I've got to say, I think Hibs have got a big task. I was for part on Saturday, watched them again. That's twice I've watched them, 2 weeks, and I've not been impressed, Gordon. But obviously, they're again with a 3-1 lead. Last week, about 7, 8 o'clock, we were sitting here thinking that Hearts would probably potentially go out. They lost two early goals away from home with Rosenborg. But that man, Shanklin, got them back in the tie. And they've got to really capitalise on that tonight at a full house Tynecastle. Looking forward to a couple of games and looking forward to the calls about the tickets.
01419511025. Get your calls into us then. You can tweet as well, as Gordon quite rightly says. That may be one of the topics for you tonight. Celtic have knocked back Rangers' offer of 708, to be precise, tickets for the upcoming game at Ibrox. So no away fans at Ibrox. And of course, that will then rumble on. It remains to be seen how that sorts itself out, if at all, for the next game, when Rangers come to Celtic Park, because by all accounts Rangers still intend to take up their allocation in accordance with SPFL rules. Celtic, it remains to be seen how they will handle that one. So on and on we go on that never ending topic, but I know it does mean a lot to you fans out there, so get in touch and let us know your thoughts on that. I know a lot of people like to go back and sort of bemoan the reasons that we got here, which is fine. Anyone get any potential solutions? Because it seems like we're further away than ever. That would be nice. Give us your ideas. 0141 951 1025. Hearts and Hibs fans would love to hear from you. In particular, Hearts fans, it might be a bit easier because you're at home. Maybe you're heading along to the game tonight. Maybe you're settling down to watch it. Mark Wilson's got you with more chance of going through than Hibs somehow.
Mark my words. We'll see at the end of play.
I'm with you, mate. I'm agreeing with him.
Yeah. I didn't hear you back me up when Gordon.
No, I like to chuckle. Shouldn't be now. I like the chuckle. I like you get something wrong, but I'm with you tonight. I think Hearts will win at a Tynecastle. I think Hibs will struggle.
Okay, well, get your thoughts in there. 01419511025. Gustaf Lagerbielke, this time last night, the news broke that he had completed his move to Celtic. So, Celtic fans, you're going to hear from him. You can react off the back of that if you like what you're hearing. Maybe you've had time to do a bit more research. Maybe you've had more time to think about how he fits in and what's next, what else needs done to that squad. Is that the defence sorted? Is there still more to be done there? Is there something else you'd like to see? Do let us know. 01419511025 or Twitter at Clyde SSB. Are you both okay? We're 5 minutes in.
7 and 8.
You're dropping things. I can hear you knocking
things
over. There was a noise.
What was that?
I thought it was his phone.
It was my bottle of water. Was it? Oh! Blame it. You had us panicking there. We're like, no, I was convinced it was his phone.
You both seem very twitchy tonight, no?
Yeah, he keeps. Well, we're very close.
I know, but don't.
Being this close to him, I'm almost touching his hairy arms. Look at the hair on there.
Watch my muscles don't hurt you.
He's still hitting the gym for all those listening on the radio.
Luckily, the calls are coming in, which can take us away from that. 01419511025. The two big games tonight, the signing of Lagerbielke. Anything else out there? Derek McInnes has been speaking today. Still feels a bit aggrieved at a penalty decision against Celtic last season in the Cup. So he's hoping that things go more in his favour when the sides meet in the League Cup this weekend. It is, of course, Viaplay Cup time. So a break already for the Scottish Premiership. It feels like we're just getting going. But yeah, get all your thoughts into us, please, on that usual number. Right, so that's story today. And I feel like this is one of those topics that we could do a 5-hour phone in on and go round and round in circles on it, because we've done it before and we will do it again. But it is new, it is fresh, so let's get stuck in. I did say when we came back after the summer, I didn't feel like we'd truly be back until we argued about something like a ticket allocation. You know, the real staples of the Scottish football debate that keep us going year after year. So let's do it. I'm not sure we can... I think we'll get round in circles quite quickly on it, but let's do it nevertheless. Celtic have rejected a ticket offer from Rangers for that upcoming clash at Ibrox. The reports are that the Parkhead side were offered 708 tickets for the game on September the 3rd. Usual, you know, over in the kind of corner between the Broomloan Road and the Sandy Jardin stands. However, Celtic have knocked that back, so there'll be no travelling fans. Rangers say that they were seeking extra security measures for the game, liaising with Police Scotland after security fears from previous meetings. But that wasn't enough to change the mind of Celtic. They've stood firm. But then the next twist, the next argument that you're about to have, Rangers will still demand that they're offered the same allocation for the next fixture at Celtic Park under SPFL laws. So are we actually in a scenario where there will be no away fans at Ibrox, but there will be away fans at Celtic Park? Or are Celtic going to dig in there and go against that rule?
We've kind of been here before, but it's not
clearing itself up anyway.
I think it's only fair that Celtic have been offered these tickets. They didn't take them. They have safety concerns, and they're quite right to air those concerns. And it's up to them whether they want to take them or not. They've decided not to take them. It's only fair that Rangers get offered a similar allocation. It's then over to Rangers if they have safety concerns, or they're quite fine where their away support will be seated. And if they're happy with that, then there should be 708 Rangers fans at Celtic Park. If Celtic don't want to take their allocation, then that's fine. This has rumbled on for a while now. And listen, a lot has came through the fans.
Celtic agree to that though?
Sorry?
Celtic be happy with that, do you think?
So how can they not be? They've been offered, it's their gift to... They've rejected it. Yeah, they've rejected it. So it's only fair that they offer Rangers the exact same arrangement. Now, if Rangers say that they're happy, they think their supporters are safe, then there will be Rangers fans inside Celtic Park. But Celtic are right to air their concerns, because we've seen in previous games, you know, some of the incidents that have taken place where the fans have been seated in that corner. And I think they've taken a lot of their advice from the actual fans. I think when you look in social media, there's a huge volume of Celtic fans that have encouraged Celtic to reject these tickets, and they'd be quite happy in doing so. So I think they're fine. I don't think we're ever going to get back to a fair system until, again, we've discussed that we're back to our allocation pre 2019 or 2020 or whenever that was, where it was 8,000 Celtic fans and similar Celtic Park with Rangers fans. But that takes a lot of planning, because of the season tickets that go out. Rangers fans are obviously got their season tickets for that stand, and Celtic fans vice versa. So there's been an offer there. Celtic's rejected that. I think it's only fair that they put the same offer to Rangers.
I think the one bit that you'll never get away from, Gordon, and it doesn't make any difference now really, because it's gone way beyond this. I think for us, certainly, and for a lot of fans on both sides, it just feels like a shame all round that what was once brilliant about the spectacle has gone. Not everyone feels that way, but I think that's sort of how the neutrals, if you like, or the outsiders, and you know, the product and TV and all that sort of stuff. Are those days just completely gone? Do we need to forget that?
Yeah, I think we do. I'm one of those that I'm sad of that, Gordon.
And you guys who played in it always say that, don't you?
I'm a bit older than Mark, just a bit. I grew up with that fixture. When you go to Celtic Park, and I was very fortunate. I played as a young player there at Celtic Park when it was called the Rangers End was full, and Celtic had the rest of the stadium. We'd come to Ibrox, it was one end, and that's when Mark would recognise that. Celtic had one end of the stadium, Rangers had the other three stands. It made for the atmosphere. The Rangers-Celtic game, Celtic-Rangers game, were always built in atmosphere, but I think that's gone, as in the amount of supporters.
Yeah. Let's not steal Kenny's thunder, because Kenny's in Rutherglen. I've got a funny feeling he's on a similar theme. Kenny, is that fair?
Evening, gents.
Hello, how are you?
I'm fine, thank you, and yourselves?
Yeah, not bad, not bad at all. So what are your thoughts on this?
I just feel like it's a bit of nonsense because the Celtic Rangers games are probably the biggest games in Scotland, and maybe not Scotland, but Europe. And no seeing the atmosphere and no feeling it, it doesn't feel right to me. I know everyone's got their opinions, but I just feel I should go back to the 8,000 Celtic fans at Ibrox behind the Brulon goal, and the same for Celtic Park, because with the two sets of fans in, it's a better atmosphere.
The problem is, Kenny, how do we ever get back to that? So obviously Rangers, you know, made it pretty clear they've sold season tickets for that area, that, you know, there's the demand there. Those people are now in their seats. You can't presumably, you know, just suddenly now move them for Celtic fans to sit there when those fixtures come around. So I think loads of people will feel the way you do about it, but in practice, how do we do that? What's the solution now? How do you get there?
Well, would that not be the same for Celtic fans who's bought seats in the Lisbon Lions fans where the Rangers fans would sit? If they're saying that, then would that not be the same for the Celtic fans who's
bought seats? It's got to be 2 years at least prior planning. You know, you've got to give those supporters who have purchased their season tickets and been promised that we're looking after yous now. Rangers have said we're looking after our own fan base. Celtic have said the same. We want more of your crowd in there. There's a season ticket for you, and they've bought this up. And a lot of these fans have waited in season ticket queues for a long, long time. If you're reversing the decision, you've got to give them adequate time to put things in their mind. Now, bear in mind, they'll only be missing two games. They'll still get their season ticket in that seat. They are missing the two biggest games, and they've got to make peace with that. It was acceptable before, so I don't see how it's that far a stretch for it to be acceptable if you give them enough prior planning.
What do you think?
Yeah, I'm with Kenny on the phone. I find it sad because I think it's our biggest game. It's a showpiece game. It's showed all around the world, Gordon. It's a fantastic game to be a part of, and I think the atmosphere makes that. I totally understand that clubs nowadays look after their own supporters. Even if you go, you know, we've had the argument before with Motherwell or Kilmarnock not selling out another stand to Rangers or Celtic because they're more interested in the season ticket holders that come every second week to support their team at home. And I can take that on board. But if you flip the coin over, I think Hearts this season have still kept allocation for Hibs because it's a derby and they want to keep that atmosphere. So I can understand that side of it. But going back to the first point, if Celtic have been made the offer from Rangers about the tickets, it was only fair that Celtic must make that offer back to Rangers. And it's up to them whether they accept that or not.
Yeah, I mean, I think as things stand, Rangers expect the offer and expect to take it.
That's fair enough.
I think then overall, you know, like it's very hard to separate yourself from the two sides of this argument. Everything in Scottish football sort of comes around these two sides from a distance. If you zoom out, you've then just got that weird situation where the outcome is away fans at one game and not away fans at the next, which just feels weird in the sort of balance of a season. But I guess in the individual circumstance of each fixture, is that the way it's just going to be?
I think so. Listen, as long as they were both offered the same, then it is Celtic's responsibility to either take that or pass it up, and they've passed it up, so they can have no complaints when it comes round. There can be no argument about we didn't have any fans in the ground and we were up against 50,000 Rangers supporters. People will argue, well, what difference does 700 make? That's a conversation we've had before. Some people say that does make a difference because you can visually see your fan base there, you're representing them, even if it is 700 or 8,000, and others think it may galvanise you or go against you. There's arguments for both sides, but Celtic's been given a choice and they've rejected it. And I was going to say, Kenny's point, it was the biggest game in the UK, and he said maybe the biggest game in Europe, but we're getting further and further away from that because the product on the pitch, you know, let's be honest, isn't comparable to the top leagues in Europe now. You know, the players we can attract here for this fixture, you know, the passion, the colour, the pace of the game, the rivalry in the ground on the day was what makes this fixture so special. You take away a big part of that, then we're diluting it even further.
Yeah, you go into the sort of I'm talking about the football bit here, because I know that clubs have got the reasons for doing whatever, but you get to that, it was almost like a kind of, how would you describe it, like the freak show element of last year. Like, oh, I wonder what's going to happen if someone scores and it's silent, and we've not had it yet. So the last two games of last season, the home side won the game, obviously. You know, Celtic won at Celtic Park, Rangers won at Ibrox. And there's that sort of morbid intrigue of like, oh, I wonder what will happen when the away team wins with no away fans. But it's just...
Mark Turty's on a great point. People do tune in all over the world for the atmosphere of that game. Like, there's no doubt about it. Whether it's a good atmosphere, bad atmosphere, you can argue all day long. But it was the fact of growing up Celtic and Rangers and getting into that stadium and hearing the noise from both sets of supporters as a player standing in that tunnel, and Mark's been there many times. It was an incredible feeling, Gordon. That's been taken away. And I do agree with Mark a little bit in the sense that the product in the park isn't, you know, that great.
So, like, what is your selling point?
Your unique selling point was the colour, the passion, what you're watching. Yes, that brought the best out in the players, and it maybe took them up a notch, that made the game more interesting.
I think when you're entrenched though on one side though, some people still won't feel that. We'll find out on the phones as an example. So was it the February game, you know, the big one that kind of turned the tide, Celtic hammered Rangers at Celtic Park. Three, that one?
Anyway, the first one, 3-0,
and there was no Rangers fans. Celtic fans wouldn't have complained about a bad atmosphere that night.
Of course not. Apparently that night in particular, it was electric. I totally get that argument. You could also make it, you know, would it have been better if there was a section of Rangers fans in there to every goal that went in, it makes it that wee bit better.
Let's ask Alan, who's a Rangers fan. Kenny gave us a Celtic take. Alan, what's your thoughts on it?
Good evening, panel. I actually phoned you about 3 weeks ago when it reared its head, and I was just saying to the producer there is no answer now. And that was my point about 3 weeks ago. Rangers have now got that many season ticket holders with 14,000 in the waiting list, where in the past, I think you were given a cheaper seat in the Broomland Road, and you got one Celtic game because they moved you about. There is nowhere to put these fans now. So these people in the Broomland Road have got their season tickets, so there's no answer. It's 700 or nil. That's it. This will never change because these people are paying money up front, good money, so where do you put them? Are you going to try and sell a season ticket without Rangers Celtic games? You're not going to sell it.
But I disagree with that. You are going to sell it. You sold it before. For years before, you did sell it without two Celtic games in there. May have sold it for a cut price than what you would sell a premium. But Rangers fans still bought it. They still bought that ticket because they were going to see Rangers play everybody else in the league.
Is it once it's gone there, getting it back?
But that's what I was saying. That you can't just say, by the way, next year we're reverting back, and then you've left your fans in the lurch a bit. You have got, it may take a couple of years.
No, but there's still more season ticket holders now, though, I would imagine. That's why. So it's where they go. So Chris sent a tweet in to say, I've got a ticket in the Broomloan rear. Previously, we were moved to another section for Old Firm games. I'd happily move if my seat elsewhere was guaranteed, but it now can't be due to the number of season ticket holders.
So would Tino renew his season ticket without two games?
Not getting any. So Alan's saying, he says, is a compromise similar to what happens in Europe? 2,500 tickets for away fans with the same security measures that are in place for high-risk European teams.
Yeah, I agree with the caller. I don't think we're going back to, as much as I would love to. Obviously, you listen to Alan talking about the waiting list, 14,000. I agree with Mark. I think that even if you did decide in 2 years' time, look, we're going to have these season tickets, but you're not going to. I still think fans will buy tickets, right? I really do, but I don't think it's fair now. I think we're going to buy that. I think it's a case of it's a 708 or nothing. I think that is what's going to happen further down the line. I don't think we're ever going to go back to that allocation where Celtic get the Broomalone stand and Rangers get, you know, 8,000 in at the and where the old Rangers end used to be, as I call it. So I think we're at a stage now that clubs have either got to decide whether they're going to accept that 708 or it's got to be a full house of Celtic fans at Celtic Park and Rangers at Rangers.
So it would be interesting to know then, is there a level of security measure that would satisfy Celtic for that? Is there ever a scenario where Celtic are going to accept 700?
I think the problem is that corner that they're in. There's still...
I know there was talk about netting and so on, yeah. Which I don't know if, I think it wasn't going to be ready for this
so
time.
So there's still but... Rangers fans above them in the Brumon, and is that the Sandy Jardine stand, is it? So there'd still be fans. That is a security concern. In this fixture, let's be honest, it is a security concern. If that was widened, should I say, I suppose, perhaps, but...
Alan, I take it, well, how do you see it? Will Rangers accept their allocation, I assume? There's no reason not to for the next one.
I think Rangers will accept it, and yep. I think they've already, Mr. Bygrove's already come out and says we're taking an allocation. Listening to the panel there about the security, Celtic's had 700 fans in there before. I think it's just getting a bit picky now. They're wanting a bigger allocation. It's not going to harm, so they're just saying we're not taking anything. But I think Rangers will, and they're quite right to take them.
Thank you, Alan. 01419511025. Tell you what, this topic, even if it is a bit repetitive, it lights those phone lines up. We've been here before. We might find ourselves here again. Keep them coming.
You are the voice of Scottish football. Call 01419511025. Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Mark Wilson and Gordon Dalziel are here. It is a big night for Scottish clubs in Europe, and we will get to that. I would love to hear from you Hearts and Hibs fans, because it is finally poised. Even although Hibs are leading and Hearts are trailing, these two think Hearts have got more chance of progressing. Sorry, Lee Johnson, or any Hibs fans, if you are listening. There is the latest instalment, I think it's instalment number 457 on the Old Firm ticket allocation debate. It's raised its head again, so if you've got any thoughts on that, and by the looks of the phone lines, quite a few of you do, keep them coming on the usual number or on Twitter at ClydeSSB. Get your thoughts over to us. Jordan is just down the road in Clydebank. How's it going, Jordan?
Not bad, thanks very much.
You got, give me a solution, Jordan. Don't come on and say, I wish it was back to the old way. Let's look forward.
Well, my solution is hopefully a way to get it back to the old way, because I think that's when the derby was at its best.
Okay.
Now, my potential solution would be that obviously the biggest issue I feel is these seats are no longer available. These 7,000 seats have been given to season ticket holders.
Mm-hmm.
So my solution would be that the 7,000 people that would have to be moved in order to accommodate the away fans would be given first refusal on the away game, so that everybody's still getting two games a season.
Okay. I did ask for solutions. And we're at the stage where I'll take any or any suggestion.
Not any. That is a fantastic suggestion. Jordan, well done. Take a bow.
Is it a bit...
Thank you very much.
I like your creativity. I like you've offered. Yeah. I just wonder though, are you sort of putting two and two together and coming up with five? Fans don't... Just because you want a season ticket at your home ground doesn't mean you want to go to the away game. I would. You know, when I was lucky and I was young, and when I used to go to Motherwell games, I'd go away and home, and that was just part of it. But it's not linked the same for everyone. Do you know what I mean?
Right. Fans have genuine safety concerns about going to an away ground, and especially in this fixture. Listen, I remember
But not even to make it as serious as that. You know, I don't know if it equates itself.
No, it doesn't, but I'm just stating an example that when I was younger and I went to the home game, Celtic Rangers game, my dad would never take me to Ibrox. And so if that got offered to someone in a similar vein, say a Rangers fan, maybe they wouldn't want to travel to Celtic Park, so they're hard done by. But or put the 7,000 in a ballot. You get ballots for cup finals and big European games. You know, you go on a ballot and it's your luck.
I think that's what Jordan's trying to avoid, isn't it, Jordan? I know ticket ballots for Glasgow's Big Two are fairly difficult procedures.
Well, because I know not everybody would want to go to the away game. Some people prefer it. So you could have people that would prefer to go to the away game. You could opt in and then opt in that way, so that people aren't getting moved when they don't want to be. So everybody, people that want to go to the away game are the ones that are going to the away game.
Mm-hmm. See, if it's even close to making sense, I'll accept it tonight, because like we said, all this does every single time is sort of cast up the same discussion, really, about how let's try and go back, but we can't, and that we lose the colour and we lose the atmosphere, and it does feel like we're just never getting anywhere. This one's maybe a bit different. The thing that sets today's story apart is the fact that Rangers are now expecting the same offer for Celtic Park. They expect it to be offered. They expect to take it in accordance with SPFL rules. Mm-hmm. And therefore you will have this uneven, if you can call it that, scenario where there are no Celtic fans at Ibrox, but there will be Rangers fans at Celtic Park.
But that's
what makes this one a bit different.
Yeah, it does. But that's a decision, rightly or wrongly, that Celtic have decided to do. They feel, for the safety of their supporters, that they're not happy with the security for Celtic supporters to go along there. So they've rejected the tickets, and they're every right to do that. That's the decision of the club. Whereas Rangers are the opposite. Rangers feel that, you know, whether it's 708 fans or whatever it may be.
Very specific as well, wasn't it?
Yeah. They feel that for the 708 fans, they should have the option to say, yeah, I want to go along to Celtic Park and support my team. So I don't see the problem in whether Celtic have rejected or Rangers have accepted. What I'm saying is that it's got to be the fact that Rangers have got the option to accept or reject.
Just out of curiosity, Jordan, what's your own personal circumstance here? Do you go? Are you a season ticket holder? Did you used to go? Are you just an interested spectator?
I used to have a season ticket holder. I used to be a season ticket holder. I'm not anymore. I just think it should go back to the way that it used to be, and I would like, in any way that would be possible, I think should be looked into.
Yeah, I think you can almost break it to stakeholders, they call it, isn't it? Different stakeholder. Every player I've ever heard from who's played in the fixture likes the maximum allocation. Yeah, I think.
Yeah.
If there's anyone out there who wants to correct that, feel free. You then, I think most, if there is such a thing, the neutrals, I think, again, would agree. And then in amongst the fan bases, now it feels like there's a bit of a split. So, you know, Jordan just wants it to go back. You can understand now, though, like, how do you make that happen? And some people actually don't want it at all. Like, you know, have any desire to see it that way. But I feel like certainly the players all do.
Certainly, the players, everyone I've spoken to, myself included, Daz, people have been there and experienced that atmosphere. Of course they want that back. Yeah, there is a split in the fans, and the fans that don't want it, then that's who the hierarchy at both clubs are listening to. They're taking in the concerns of that group of supporters and running with it. And, you know, it's going to be very difficult to change their mind, because clubs are of course correct to have the best interest and the safety of their fans at heart. It's the most important thing at any football club. But they also want to
market the game.
Of course, that's what I was looking for. They also want to market this game, our game, in the best possible light. Mm-hmm. And Celtic and Rangers are by far the biggest catch in Scotland. Kenny, on first, he described it as one of the biggest fixtures in Europe. And by the way, at its peak, it was, with the colour and passion that came with it and the players that visited this country. But we're a long way away from that now.
I was going to bring in the Rangers side of things there. The callers just disappeared whilst Jordan was on, so we'll get another one lined up imminently, I am sure. Don't know where he's gone, but thank you to Jordan. It's a solution. I'll take any.
That's the best tonight. We'll put him in the
By hat. The way, yeah. See if that happens in the next couple of years. I hope Jordan gets some credit for that.
Did you see the way Jordan come on with his suggestion there, and he's not even got a season ticket himself?
He's getting up 7,000 to the other ones. Send them to the East End.
Well, Jordan, at least it was an idea, right?
Absolutely.
Rather than the nets. Somebody came on, was it a few weeks ago, and put nets up?
No, but I think that is a genuine part of the discussion. I think I read that earlier.
I think that should be thrown out. I mean, talking about the actual occasion and how it looks visually. Imagine seeing visually, you know, nets up surrounding the away crowd at either ground. It would look ridiculous. It would actually be to the detriment of
What interests me, and I totally agree, I'm not arguing against Celtic's decision here, right? They've every right as a football club to make that decision. But you just wonder that if they did decide, the 708 fans that probably would die for a ticket to go along and support Celtic at Ibrox.
100%. Some of those fans that went, and that when that was the allocation, but some of them says it was the best away day that they've had, because they felt so up against the odds. Yeah, I think what happened after that. There was a few incidences then.
So does every Celtic fan agree with the decision that that Celtic have made. And listen, I'm not knocking
Celtic.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Is every fan sitting there thinking the club has made the right decision for 708 supporters?
I think as long as the official line is security concerns, then they will. I don't think it's ever going to be a case of, look, we don't think this is safe, but if you want to crack on and see, have a laugh with it, you know, the clubs need to sort of make that decision, don't they?
Mm. Yeah, look, I'm not arguing against Celtic's decision. They've looked at the overall picture and decided to go. Mm. But, and that's, they're every right to do that. But I was just wondering, as a fan who's probably, maybe fans that have been there in the past and thought, yeah, you know.
Let's ask Scott, who's on the line. What do you think, Scott?
Good evening, guys. First and foremost, good luck to the two clubs in Europe tonight, because I think we could do be doing with both teams getting through.
Well said.
There's some good nights in Europe as well for us.
Absolutely.
I watched Hibs last week and I thought they played really well in the second half. Don't know what they're doing in their league games, mind you, but they've done well in their European ties. I'm disgusted by the way it's all went on. I've had my season book for the best part of 35 years. So I've been to Ibrox when it was half empty in the Rangers' end. I've sat in the Govan stand when Celtic were given tickets there. I've sat in the Broomland Road, the main stand, the enclosure. And then slowly but surely over the years, the away allocation has been whittled down. 1993, Rangers decided to lock us out. I think you all remember that. It was either 93 or 94 when John Collins had scored. And yeah, that was David Murray back then, who just, pardon my dog having a bat there.
Come on, Henrik, settle down.
He's got to be ready to join in.
Henrik's not happy.
He's only about the size of a hamster and all, but making enough noise. And David Murray decided that because there'd been some damage to Rangers Stadium, he decided to lock out the Celtic fans. Now, way back then, the SPFL or the SFA or whoever their governing body was should have made sure that there was a percentage put in place that the away club, the home club, must offer the away fans or the away team. Right now, it's a gentleman's agreement, which is open to, as you well know, is open to widespread just carnage. And right now, what they've done is, in my opinion, is they've ruined one of the football's best ever derbies. It is ruined now. Chelsea have been there, I think that's six times now. They've had two members of staff hit with bottles. They've had Joe Hart in goal, going into a shattered goal mouth, shattered bottle in the goal mouth. And they had a fan hit, I think it was their last game, or the game before that, possibly. So this is all Rangers doing. Celtic can still go back to 8,500 tickets. We've got I think it's 8,500 special season ticket holders that only get game that don't get the Rangers games on their book. It's then offered to them, obviously because of the way it is just now, they're then offered to buy the tickets for their own seat. My dad's one of them, he's got a special season ticket holder. So I know that for a fact, but Celtic still have that in place. So we can go back to easily. The difference is Rangers can't because they've sold the seats. And see, before I just go off, can I just say one other thing?
Mm-hmm.
How come they could allocate 2,500 seats to the Newcastle fans for a friendly game?
Well, was that on the season ticket? Would that have been on the season ticket though? Is that not the issue?
Immaterial, surely that's immaterial. You can do it for a friendly game, but you can't do it for a league game.
No, but you're not comparing like for like. I mean, you're not having to display season ticket holders. That's all I mean. I don't know, Gordon. Scott has a more in-depth knowledge of Celtic's current ticket setup than I do, which isn't surprising. That's mm-hmm. why it's great that we can get fans on, because they know who's got what ticket and for yeah. where. Scott speaks as one, you know, who just thinks it's been basically ruined over the years.
Yeah, look, Scott goes on to point the finger a lot at Rangers and.
Well, the
Ibers,
thing about some of these, the problem with this is, like, and let me be abundantly clear, of course, what happened to Joe Hart is completely unacceptable, but not entirely linked to the ticket allocation debate.
Yeah.
That's what I would say on that one.
Yeah, I agree with where Scott talks about what is taken away from the actual fixture. And Mark touched on it earlier. What makes that fixture, even if it's the standard on the pitch isn't great, and sometimes it's not great at all, is the fact of the atmosphere. It's the fans. Because everybody has said since day one that a ball was kicked, it's all about the fans. And the fans make that fixture. And that's why everybody was so interested in it. That's why it was worldwide. That's why it was one of the biggest derbies going about. There's no doubt in that. As a player, that was the one game growing up as a young kid, if you supported Rangers or Celtic, or you signed with Rangers or Celtic through the boys club or S Form or whatever it may be, you wanted to play in Gordon. And it was because of the atmosphere especially. And that's been taken away. I agree. I think it has diminished the fixture. And it's a pity because that is our showpiece fixture.
Quickly, Scott, because I'm very, very late. Are you, I think happy is the wrong word, but if this is the way it's going to play out now, no Celtic fans at Ibrox, are you okay that in the next game there will be Rangers fans at Celtic Park? Should they just be offered the allocation and get to accept it?
No, of course I'm not. Why should they?
How do you fix that bit, though? But how do you fix that bit?
They started all this. They're the ones that took down the allocation. Celtic have refused it because they don't feel that their supporters are safe. And to be fair, their players haven't been safe either, have they? Or their backroom staff. So how do we go about that?
That's what I'm saying. How do you now fix that, though? You know, because Celtic were... And again, I'm not saying Celtic were wrong to knock it back. I don't want you to misunderstand me on that. But it was Celtic's decision. Celtic were... It was their prerogative. Will the same not just happen the next way around?
It's not prerogative. It's not about prerogative, it's about safety. That's why Celtic... I've been in the 800. And I'll tell you something. It's not a nice place to be. You've got Rangers fans less than 15 yards away from you on one side. Rangers fans less than 15 yards away from the other side. And you're well open to missiles being thrown. I was lucky in that game. I don't think they've seen any missiles. But then again, Celtic won 2-0.
So you don't think there will be Rangers fans at Celtic Park for the next game?
No, I can't say that because I don't make the rules. But if I was Celtic, I wouldn't offer that. Rangers were good enough to do it in 1993, so you're not getting any tickets. Well, we can do the same.
Yeah, I must admit, I can't remember the exact... I don't know if things have changed in the sort of 20 years. I think the SPFL rules sort of say that there needs to be an offer made. So I don't know. Watch this space. Anyway, we're very late for this.
Oh, you're kidding me on.
Oh, thank you. Oh, my goodness.
The cash register. Clyde
One. Yeah, it's a rollover on the cash register after the call went to five rings. So now it's your chance to win £25,000 tomorrow when we make the next call. Enter now by texting YES to 61025, YES to 61025. Do that right now and you'll get five entries for the price of one text entry. You like a bargain.
Yeah.
You like a bit of good value.
I can't enter.
If you get the call from us after 3 p.m. tomorrow, answer within five rings. Make sure you know the correct cash register amount. Texts are £2 plus your standard network rate. Online entries £2 or call 0330 880 4523, and the calls are charged at a standard rate over 18s only, and entries since Aston won on Wednesday have rolled over. All the rules for this Hits Radio Network Scotland competition are on our website. So for your chance to win £25,000, text YES to 61025.
0141 951 1025. This is Scottish football's league leader, Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Gordon Dalziel and Mark Wilson are in the building. They're about to be joined, not in the building, but on the phones, by Andy, who's a Rangers fan in Motherwell. Take it away, Andy.
How you doing, guys?
Good, how are you?
I'm all right, just having a laugh at some of the calls.
Oh, I'm glad we've provided some comic relief for you tonight, Andy. What in particular?
Just, it's the age-old blame someone rather than just look at the whole incident. The whole nonsense about the tickets has been a farce since the get-go. I think Rangers were entitled to cut them down at the start. I think it's gone a bit too long now. I do believe maybe even the European allocation is the best way to go back to. But it's not just about safety. The safety fears kind of, it makes me laugh more to do with the fact that it's both ways. I've been to Parkhead away games, been stuff thrown at me and stuff like that, but I don't really complain about it. I just go on with it because it's part and parcel of going to games sometimes. But the saying that they're not safe, every other away fan that comes to Ibrox, you don't seem to have an issue with. So it's strange that it's just them. But anyway,
a couple of things. All right, firstly, part and parcel of going, should it be though? And again, both ways, if you like. I think most people, listen, it's impossible for us to constantly, you know, when someone accuses one set of fans of something, and then you need to balance that up by pointing out, oh, this set of fans also do think, you know, it's very difficult. Yes, you're right. There are people who misbehave in all sorts of fan bases. Should it be part and parcel of going to a game?
That nonsense, no. I can't stand it. I can't stand that. I can't stand certain things that get done in stadiums. Unfortunately, you're never going to eradicate at all. It's been there since I've been going to Rangers or Celtic or Motherwell, wherever I've been. I've been in Mullow End and heard a lot of bad stuff, but it's something that I don't think you'll ever eradicate fully. But I believe a lot of the issue with the tickets is more to do with where you're sat. Have you ever been into Parkhead away seats?
Yeah.
They're horrible. A lot of them behind stanchions. It's not the greatest of stadiums to be sitting in that section. We then give them right behind the goals, unrestricted views. Why not do it the other way about? Why not do it where we get right behind the goals as well at Parkhead?
I've seen that argument, Mark, as well. I've seen some Rangers fans pointing out they don't like... I mean, to be fair, the old allocation... Let me get that. So if we're talking the 7,000, not everyone is in the corner, surely, Andy, for 7,000. You know, It comes round.
Yeah. A bit, but it's not... You're no further than 18 yards, as far as I can remember.
It comes about a third over.
Third round, yeah.
Listen, that's a legitimate, probably... argument concern for Rangers fans that they get the corner. Yeah,
I do want, and again, I don't have the same sort of horse in the race, so to speak. Is that something that's been sort of added retrospectively? Is that actually a reason for
I don't think it's a reason. Yeah, I think people are just adding that on, and it may be a legitimate concern for some Rangers fans who have been there and experienced that. But you know, Andy, you opened up there saying that Rangers had every right to cut the allocation, and you says then it's went a bit, it's got kind of a joke now, it's went too far. But was Rangers that cut the allocation at the start?
And they're still back in talks trying to sort out. That's the whole point of this today. And I'm not saying it will go straight back to... I don't believe it should go back to the full stand, especially if we're still in the corner. But there is a way dealing with it, and it could be going up to the away allocation of the European teams. And that's maybe been spoke about. We don't really know what's happening in the background, but it's easy to turn around and throw stones at Rangers and say, oh, they started this. They started it for a reason. It was becoming a joke the way Celtic were brushing Rangers aside, trying to get his banned from all sorts. I just feel as if there was a lot of stuff in the background that was quite nasty coming from that side as well, and that's why Rangers decided, well, we'll just cut the allocation. It was just a kind of reason to have a go at Celtic, but that's done. It doesn't matter what it was that started it. It's trying to get it fixed. The problem in getting it fixed is, well, if the only solution at the moment is the 800 corner seats, they've still been offered them. So Rangers are within every right to then take the 800. As much as it's not going to make much of a difference and it's no great seats, they're still within the right to take them. So the last caller saying that, they shouldn't be getting them, it's part of the rules of the SPFL, as far as I'm led to believe.
Yeah, I mean, it's a pretty boring, wordy explanation, but I'll give you it for the sake of accuracy. Is it rule I-27 or something?
Yes, the SPFL it certainly is. I'm glad you brought that up.
You know it off by heart, don't
you? Yeah, rule 27, yeah.
The home club must make provision for the admission of such reasonable number of visiting supporters at every home league match as may be agreed in advance with the visiting club in the event of their being unable to agree such number, not later than 14 days prior to the date of the league match. The number of visiting supporters allowed shall be determined by the board to make the decision. That shall be final and binding.
I agree with Andy. Look, you can argue all day long. Rangers started the seating at Celtic Park's not acceptable to some Rangers fans, whatever. That's in the past. It's got to be a way forward to try.
Give me solutions, not problems. Problems,
yeah, exactly. I was coming to that. I just feel that you've got to look forward now, and you've got to get the two teams together.
Because if ever there was a time to bring the two clubs together,
the quotes are still in the book in the house. I just feel that we've got to look forward and try and get a solution to bring this game back to what it really is. It's our
showpiece
fixture, Gordon, and we've got to look after it.
Final word of the hour to Hugh Keevans, who's just sent me a message and says, thoroughly depressing. I don't know if he's talking about his own demeanour
or watching us.
Your t-shirt tonight
on the Shuggy tickets. Gaffer. Andy, thank you. Shuggy Gaffer. Thank you very much to Andy. It's that time of the night.
Beat the Pundit with the Scottish Sun.
For the best football news and opinion online, thescottishsun.co.uk/football.
Right, come on. A bit of light relief amidst the ticket allocation debate for Beat the Pundit. You'll allow us 2 minutes, won't you? It's your chance to come on and take on these two who have been in rank rotten form this season.
It's not happening for us.
You lost on Tuesday.
Aye, it's a bit
of
added pressure.
You've lost twice this season already.
About 1-1. He's no 1-1. He's 100% record.
Really, really bad.
Please phone in. 100% record. Pick the phone up. Dial the number 01419511025.
That was quite good. That was good.
I am redundant. Calls before seven. Beat the Pundits next.
Tackle the headlines. 01419511025. Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Gordon Dalziel and Mark Wilson are here. It's 01419511025. If you're just joining us, I've got two words to sum up the first hour of the show: ticket allocation. And you'll know exactly what we mean. It's that debate that we revisit every couple of weeks, but it has been taken on slightly today by the news that there will be no away fans at Ibrox for the next meeting. However, Rangers do still expect to be offered and will accept an allocation for Celtic Park in the next game. So fun and games, I think, on the phones tonight. 01419511025. Gustaf Lagerbielke speaking for the first time as a Celtic player. We're going to hear from him. Have you any thoughts on that? I've got this mad notion that we don't spend the full 2 hours on the ticket allocation. It's just an idea, but you guys get to decide. And we've got, of course, Hibs and Hearts coming up in Europe very soon as well. Let's play this first, though.
Beat the Pundit with the Scottish Sun.
For the best football news and opinion online, thescottishsun.co.uk/football.
Right, Beat the Pundit time, and it is getting serious. The listeners have won a lot of matches so far this season, but it's mostly you two that are letting the side down.
Not at all.
You've lost three times between you this season. This week, you're the only person that's lost.
I'm the only person. Really? I'm the only person that's won.
Marvin
between
Bartley
us.
Even won last night.
The Duck won.
The Duck?
He won last night.
Man, he got a Duck last week, didn't he?
Yeah, but he bounced back. He got a zero last week. He's bounced back. Andy Halliday got an 8 on Monday.
8
is the level that you aspire to. It's only 8-5 to the Pundits this season.
Oh, it's very close.
Yeah. A lot of balls going out the door.
Indeed, there is.
It's all yours.
Let's bring in Robert, who's in West Lothian. How's it going, Robert?
I'm good.
Have you ever played before, Robert?
I have. Round about exactly this time last year, right. Gordon gave his famous answer when I played him.
Oh, well, he's had a few. Which one are you?
It was PSV Amsterdam.
No way.
Okay, Rob.
So you're the PSV, you're the guy that put Gordon under so much pressure that he thought the team was PSV Amsterdam.
Aye, and then flicked it on a tiebreaker after it. So
did you win that night?
Yeah, I won that night. Listen, we Rab, come on.
That just shows you though, I just assumed that you lost that night.
No.
Somebody made him a mug.
Yeah, you got a mug sent in, didn't you? A PSV Amsterdam mug sent in on the back
of it. Gordon definitely lost, just to clear that up. He definitely lost that night.
Oh, you lost.
I lost.
Yes, you did. I've got a ball.
Oh, right. I thought you said he flicked it in the tie break. Right, you flicked it. Sorry. Good, that's what I like. Okay, well,
I'm no
listen.
Good tiebreaker.
It might be a rematch. It might be Mark Wilson
it's
heads.
Your number.
Well, you got 100% defeat. You
heads,
you?
It's Mark. Tails, okay. It's Gordon. It's the rematch. It's
PSV come on.
Amsterdam.
Right, Rab.
Up against Robert from West Lothian.
I enjoy watching you here.
Ooh.
Get that camera zoomed in nice and tight on that beak. Right, Robert, 30 seconds to Gordon.
Didn't even say good luck to him.
Answer as many as you can and pass if you don't know the answer, okay?
No worries.
Right, 30 seconds and your time starts now. What football team's stadium will you find on Dens Road?
Dundee.
Who is the current manager of Ayr?
Pass.
What two teams played in last year's League Cup final?
Celtic and Rangers.
Name any of the two scorers in the first leg of the Hibs-Luzerne tie. Any of the three scorers, sorry.
Martin Boyham.
Who have Partick Thistle been drawn against in the SPFL Trust Trophy this afternoon?
Pass.
What club did Celtic sign Gustaf Lagerbielke from?
Oh my god. Elfsborg.
Okay. Gordon DL, can you hear us? Can you hear us?
I'm back.
That was loud, that was good though.
Yeah,
was it,
yeah. It was the Eagles.
What was it again? Or was it?
Hotel, wherever
Amsterdam.
Amsterdam, yes. Welcome to the Hotel
Eindhoven.
You can book out any time you want. Come on, let's go for this.
Okay, 30 seconds on the clock. Your time starts now. What football team's stadium would you find on Dens Road?
Dundee.
Who is the current manager of Ayr?
I can't remember his name, Pat.
What two teams played in last year's League Cup final?
Rangers Celtic.
Name one of the scorers in the first leg of Hibs Luzerne.
Deutsch.
Who have Partick Thistle been drawn against in the SPFL
Pass.
Trust Trophy this afternoon? What club did Celtic sign Gustaf Lagerbielke from?
Eifberg. I can't remember. Eifberg or something. Borg. Eifberg.
Eindhoven.
Iceberg.
What was the
name of it?
Iceberg,
what?
Was that?
No. I-F-E-B-O-R-G or something like
that. Well, hold on. Spell that again.
No, no. It's something like
I-F-B. E-R-G.
No, B-O-R-G or something.
B-O-R-G. Okay.
What was it? Robert, that's me, rabbit's got me all
Robert,
over.
What do you think? Have you done enough?
I mean, I was as bad as Gordon there, to be fair.
You were both terrible. Which football team stadium?
Bullen,
would you...
How can I forget Lee Bullen? I've got friends.
Lee Bullen! Oh, that's terrible!
Dundee on Dens Road. Lee Bullen is the Ayr manager.
That's ridiculous.
You just don't want to give him credit.
Well,
no.
He spent all last season slotting him.
I can only apologise if Lee's listening. That's ridiculous.
That's terrible from you. We've got Rangers and Celtic in the League Cup final. Name any of the scorers from the first leg of Hibs Luzerne. You both had like educated guesses. You were both wrong. It was Venta, Newell or Obita.
Yeah.
So not Doidge and not
Well, good guess, Rob.
Partick Thistle have been drawn against Queen of the South, Marvin Bartley's side, in the SPFL Trust
Trophy. That's
tough.
Big,
I think that's tough.
No, Big John, stupid. You know, silly questions.
What club did Celtic sign
stupid.
Gustaf Lagerbielke
what is it
from?
Again? What is it?
It is Elfsborg.
Hey, there you go.
You said Iceberg.
You said Borg.
Iceborg.
It's not Bjornborg.
It's not ice. There is no mate. It's Elfsborg.
Elfsborg, but ice and elves.
Can I just say, listen.
elves
and ice. You've got to give me that. Seriously, got to give me
this
that.
This show has taken a turn, right? So
when did we Rab get?
He got Elfsborg.
Oh, did he beat me?
Yeah. So, well, producer John is obviously, he's thrown his weight around for the new season. He says that we've got to give him that.
Yeah.
No chance.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Not a chance, John.
Yes.
No way.
If I get beat up, you be quiet now.
John, bear in mind, this is a guy that called you stupid. Name
no,
it
no,
on 30
no,
seconds
no.
ago, John.
No. What was your score?
You didn't get
you
that.
You lost 3-2. John, Robert perfectly said
I spelled it.
You said I-F-B-O-R-G.
Well, how did you spell it?
E-L-F-S-B-O-R-G.
There, I got the B-O-R-G. It's all about the B-O-R-G. Ah, come on. John, where's big producer John? Get him in
no,
here.
Do you know what? Actually, I've got bad news for you.
What?
It's actually producer Chris that's made the call. You.
Oh.
He's trying to stick in with you because you always get him a stick.
Lee Bullen, I can't believe we beat me again.
Could we play it? We'll try and get the clip back as a steward's inquiry. But Mark, I'm not giving him that.
Not a chance.
It was nowhere
is he
near
getting that?
Elfsborg. It was nowhere
not
near
a chance.
What did I say?
Iceberg.
No, I didn't say Berg. I would never say Berg. I would Borg. Never say Berg. Borg.
When I asked you to spell it, you said to me
I-F-B-O-R-G. I did say that, right? So I got that sort of a wrong. But I was a wee bit flustered at the time, I've got to say.
Nope, sorry. Well done, Robert. Your second ball is on its way to West Lothian. Well done.
I can't do that. Shut up. See you later. Go away. Me Rab.
Try
and get
done
the last
you twice. Twice. And he's, what was he even saying there?
I don't know.
He's still there, Robert.
Super. Well done, Robert. Take care.
Well right. done. Well done, Robert.
Good man. I've bored.
Ah, God.
Listen, you're tearing the pundits down.
Shut up. You need to take a break. Record.
You need to take a break.
I need to.
You're looking stressed.
This studio's killing me.
He doesn't like the cameras on him.
I think that is. It must be because you had your moments last year, but you were good for a win every now and then. I think it's the cameras getting to you.
I think it is. Yeah, I think the cameras have just done me.
Okay, right. Let's hear a bit from Celtic's new signing. Why don't you get in touch? Let us know how you think from Eifborg. What you've made of him, what you've heard of him, how you think he's going to fit in, what the rest of the recruitment needs to look like. He has been speaking today. He was asked, obviously, about the history of successful Swedes at Celtic. He says it was part of the reason he was persuaded to make the move.
A big move. Perfect move, if I could say. Scottish league being better than the Swedish league, but going from one top of the table team to another. So it feels like a good step for me. Yeah, there was interest from other clubs, but you know, Celtic, yeah, with the good Swedish history, and then when you think of Celtic, you think of the fans and you think of the stadium here and Champions League nights. I was really interested right away. It's a really, really great club.
Daniel Mustorovic, is that who he's on about?
Him and Freddie Lundberg, I think those two heroes.
There are no others that spring to mind.
I don't think so. Look, he's got a lot to live up to if he's highlighting some of those players who have came from Sweden to Celtic and had remarkable careers. Then he's got a lot to live up to. But like, his attributes and what he's done in the past seem to fit the model of those players who've been successful in the past at Celtic. The transfer fee seems run a bit right for the kind of business Celtic have been doing in the past with that sort of position. You look at Starfelt, who's just went. I know he came for a wee bit more and left for a wee bit more, but still kind of in the same ballpark. It's a position that Celtic needed to address, and they addressed it quickly. Brendan Rodgers obviously realised when he got in the door that Starfelt was going out the door, and he had to pinpoint a player that was going to replace him. He's done it twice. Navroski came in pretty quickly. Now Lagerbielke has come in to boost that, and they needed it, especially with Carter Vickers going off at the weekend, and who knows how long that's going to be for.
Well, he also says he's excited to be following in the footsteps of his inspiration, Virgil van Dijk.
I will describe myself as a player that loves to win, does everything for the team. I can handle both short and long range passes, good in dueling in the air, and hopefully scores a few goals. I think Virgil van Dijk has been here before. It's a huge inspiration. Also how he's outside of the pitch and very, very professional and keen on getting better all the time. And on the pitch, of course, with his leadership and dueling passes also. He's a really good player. And extra fun with his Celtic history also. He's a great player for Celtic and did a lot of good things. He's an inspiration.
Not a bad one to try and emulate, that's for sure. Let's bring in Chester, who's a Celtic fan. Take it away, Chester.
Hi, how you doing?
Good, you?
Hi, I'm brilliant.
Good man.
I'm just looking for Mark's point of view and the new signing bringing in. He wants to be going to foot's right. Do you think he could be playing the Premier League in a few years and get a few quid for him?
Oh, wow, we've moved him on already.
I've not seen him ever much, Chester, but... Like, you've got to think that is the route that Celtic go down. It's a model for not just the player, but for Celtic. Celtic signed him, was it $3.5 million, Gordon? Or
round about that.
That is the model. He comes in, Celtic get hopefully the 5 years out of him. If it is the 5 years, then it still takes him up to an age it's people are going to take a punt on down south. But if they get 2 or 3 good years out of him and he is excelling, particularly at the Champions League, then of course, a Premier League club may come and get him. Virgil van Dijk's, I think, a bit unique in the respect that Celtic did great in the recruitment of him, and they must have studied him. They gave him a platform. The player then excelled. The player then took it on, went to Southampton and excelled at the Premier League and became the best defender in the world. So I don't know if he's going to get to that level, but it's not a bad player to aim at. And it shows he's got ambition. He says there was other clubs in the mix, but he chose to come here, and playing in Europe, playing the Champions League is a huge factor.
I think we're a bit early to go down that road.
Well, we need to establish,
get carried away with it,
if and when he's going to be a first choice centre back for Celtic.
Exactly.
Would it be? I can't imagine any turn of events. I mean, but apart from injury, obviously, that sees him replace Cameron Carter-Vickers.
Mm-hmm.
And Mike Navrotsky's just been brought in as in a very sort of similar mould, with a couple of million quid thrown at it. Young, promising talent between the three of them for two spots.
I've got to be up front here and say I don't know a lot about him or his ex-club.
Clearly.
But he's obviously come in to a big club. I like the way he talks. I think he talks with confidence. I think he believes in his own ability, which is, for me, is great for a footballer. But as you said, before we start saying about down south, he needs to find that number one spot in the defence at Celtic, because you're right, if Carter Vickers is in there fit, he's a certainty to play. He's a number one centre half, and then it's one in beside him. But it was certainly what Mark said there. It was certainly a position Celtic had to address. They've addressed it. They brought in someone for the future, and we need to let the lad settle into Scottish football and Celtic and see where he goes from there.
What do you think, Chester? Is he going to? How do you see that sort of panning out? What's the first choice duo going to be? What have you made of Navrotsky early on?
Well, I think they might be playing in Champions League. They could put it as a 3-5-2. With the freedom at the back with Taylor and Alistair Johnson wins back, right wing back, Taylor left wing back, and you never know. The freedom might be playing, it might not be two of them.
It's certainly a possibility, Mark. It's not something Brendan Rodgers did a lot in his time at Celtic. I referenced it last week. He tried it in the new camp in a bid to shore up, and it didn't really work. He absolutely might. Of course, you're sacrificing somebody further up the pitch.
Yeah. Look, the big downfall of Brendan Rodgers was when he went away in Europe and he played open, expansive football and he got stung by it.
Not always went to the Nou Camp and played that. He played Kieran Tierney.
You're playing.
I think it was Izaguirre, and it was at Gamboa.
But they were playing against an exceptional side.
I think they give away the amount of wingers he's brought in. He's not going to. Look, occasionally, Brendan Rodgers is a man for looking at opposition, and he may play a 3-5-2 occasionally for me, but the amount of wingers he brought in tells me that he's going to play a front three with a bit of pace and wide areas. So that would probably mean a back four for me. And you're right, Gordon, if he plays a 3-5-2 and plays Taylor and AJ down the right-hand side, he's having to sacrifice one of his most important players probably.
I don't think it's that bad a shout. I think...
Who's missing out?
Well, one of the wingers.
Do you mean one in?
Well, you'd play someone.
You've got five at the back.
You've got three midfield.
You've got Keogh up front.
Yeah, Keogh up front. Maeda could play, off Kyogo, or it could be somewhere high, or vice versa. You just don't know. You don't know his level of thinking. I keep going back to this. Brendan Rodgers is an elite manager. He would have studied what Celtic did last year, where they got their successes, but where their downfalls were. Their downfalls were their back four was just exposed. And was exposed
it?
Against...
Or was it they didn't take their chances when they came?
Well, they didn't take their chances, but at worst, it should be 0-0.
Probably a bigger factor, though, wasn't it?
A huge factor. You get ripped apart, the midfield was isolated, and the back four was exposed. Against the better teams, you will get picked apart. So maybe he's thinking, I don't know, but at least he's got the option. With Lagerbielke, Navrotsky and Carter Vickers, it looks like he's got three commanding centre-halves there that could fill the role, should he choose to change.
It's going to be fascinating to see how it plays out, isn't it? Because it's not the same, or it's not usually the same as, let's take Lea Labada, right? So he wasn't the first choice. He wasn't the first choice winger last year. But he plays an awful lot of football still, because you play a lot of games, and then within games you make those changes. But if it is four, if it is two in the heart of that defence, it's not something that you want to keep rotating generally, certainly not in game, and probably from match to match either. So is there a real competition on for between these three for those two spots in most of the games?
I think with any big club, particularly Celtic, there should be competition. There should be genuine competition. There should be competition for Alistair Johnson at right back and Greg Taylor. Is Ralston and Burnaby that? Not too sure. But you've certainly got it at centre half now. Is there competition for Kyogo with O? I don't think there is. So I think that's an area that should be strengthened. In the midfield, of course, is competition. But at centre back, if it is going to be two, then it leads to you giving your all. I'm not saying they don't give their all every day, but you're well aware if you drop below the standards in training midweek, you could lose your place at the weekend.
So you think all three, Chester? You think that's a possibility? Is that just Champions League? We won't see that domestically, will we?
Nah, we're not going to go away, Kilmarnock and Motherwell, and play five at the back. I'm just thinking, just in case, it could be like a Premier League team, or whatever Serie A team, Napoli. Mm-hmm. I don't know. They could just get the defence going. you need to win. That's how you win the games. A wee point here and there could get us through, do you know what I mean, to the next stage. You never know.
You never know. Thank you very much to Chester. It's 01419511025. There is a full time teaser and we're approaching kickoff for the Scottish teams in Europe tonight as well.
On Scottish football, 0141 951 1025. This is Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
It's a big night for Scottish clubs in Europe. Hibs and Hearts in action. Hearts at home to Rosenborg with a 2-1 deficit from the first leg. Hibs go to Luzerne with a 3-1 advantage. And yet both of my learned colleagues here to my left think that Hearts have a bigger chance of progressing. I wonder if you agree or disagree with that. Before we go any further, we're going to make room for those games, but let me get this up and running.
The full-time teaser with Sliding Wardrobe Solutions East Kilbride. Score winning wardrobes at their new trade counter at Colville's Road.
Like that, do you?
Look at that.
Music for the full-time teaser.
Oh, right? I love that.
I knew that would surprise you too. Thanks for listening last night, by the way. When we
tense to fair. I watch every night with my dinner, but I usually switch off when I'm doing the dishes. Run a bit this time.
Can you just keep put us on your smart speaker or your app?
But sometimes I like to do dishes
in peace. Is that like therapeutic for you? You're usually in the bath as well, listening to us. Did you not hear the full time teaser last night?
My Google wasn't working.
Right, okie doke. Well, anyway, thanks to David and the Gorbals for sending this one. It is a very simple question, very simple format. With all the big transfers going on, who are the 10 biggest transfers out of Scotland? And by the way, this is according to Transfer Market, because you know there's always a bit of debate.
Alan Hutton.
Oh no, actually he was 11 million. He was
undisclosed.
He was 10.8, Alan all Hutton. That stuff. So take this up with Transfer Market, with the who are the 10 biggest transfer fees out of Scotland according to Transfer Market.
Alan Hutton, 9 million.
Keep saying Alan Hutton, so I hope it's on that list.
Patterson,
yes.
Hutton?
No, not according to Transfer Market.
Hutton went for more money than Patterson.
No, he didn't.
9 million. Hutton went for 9 million. Patterson went for
12. Patterson.
Okay.
It's according to Transfer Market.
Tierney.
So don't waste my time with your complaints. Yes.
Tierney.
Take one more guess for now.
Dembele.
Yes. Okay, we'll leave it there no more at the moment. That is 3 out of your 10, so you're doing pretty well. Thanks to David and the Gorbals. It's fulltime@clyde1.com if you want to send your questions in.
Need to take Hutton off.
And please do.
He's wrote Hutton. Even though you've
Hutton's off the list.
You had a great tweet in there after your Beat the Pundit performance saying, did the captain of the Titanic shout Elfsborg when he saw the iceberg?
I wonder if he was sitting there steering the ship and trying to spell it. I'm in trouble here, boys.
You're in baller. Right, I think you'll do okay on that teaser. So fulltime@clyde1.com if you want to send your questions in, and please do. Right, let's start. Will we go home first? Hearts at home. They are 2-1 down from the first leg, but you've got them with a bigger chance of progressing than Hibs. Show me your thinking there.
Hearts at home. I think that goal from Shankland last weekend in Norway really gave them an edge. The full house tonight, Tynecastle will be rocking. I think if they can get off to a good start, I think they can turn that tie around. I've watched Hibs in 2 league games, no points. They looked absolutely terrible at Fir Park at the weekend. I've seen them against St Mirren at Easter Road, the same. They looked disjointed for me. I watched the second half of that game last week, and the opposition looked decent and created a right few chances. And I think if they can get an early goal against Hibs, I think it'll put them right under pressure. So I think Hibs will be the team tonight under pressure.
I would have to agree with that. I mean, Hearts, they've got players that have played at this level before, who can score goals. Daz rightly touches on the home factor is a big one. And plus Rosenborg, we touched on it last week, aren't the team that they once were. And I was listening to Andy Halliday. He was describing a bit of the game that Rosenborg, you know, like to soak up pressure and hit the counter attack, and they're very good at that. But Hearts had a lot of the ball. I think tonight Hearts will make better use of that. And with Shanklin, they've got a guy that can put the ball in the back of the net. For Hibs, pretty much like Daz, Hibs, you don't know what you're getting. at the minute. Going forward, I think they've got players that can cut most teams open. But at the back, seeing some of the goals that they've conceded is comical. So I think they're obviously likely to concede a few.
They'll need a few lines chasing them tonight. Let me just say that.
Well, look, we talk about the Tynecastle atmosphere a lot, and it doesn't guarantee anything. But I just wonder, particularly on a night like this, when you're 2-1 down, what impact it can have. Clearly you're hoping it's going to be an advantage. Is there a level of patience required though? I mean, ultimately, if Hearts score one, win 1-0 in the 90th minute and have to go on and do it in extra time, that, you know, then so be it. Is it sometimes, I'm not sure it's counterproductive as such, but, you know, it's not always guaranteed to just, you know, be okay, raucous Tynecastle, and you go out and blitz it all from the start.
No, I think that's why Shanklin's goal was so important. If you get into that game 2-0, I think as time goes on, you start to hit a little bit of the panic button, thinking we need to score two goals rather than one. So they don't need to leave their cell exposed at the back. They can play their way into the game. They can be patient. That one goal turns a full tie in its head if Hearts get it. And if they have to go to extra time, they've got the advantage of obviously playing at Tynecastle as well. So I think the goal over Norway was so important for Hearts. I would probably be thinking they'd be in trouble.
Just quickly,
let me
give you the teams. Clark in goal, it's Atkinson, Kent, Rowles and Kingsley at the back, Devlin and young Aidan Denham given the nod to play in midfield. Huge night. Oda, Boyce and Cochrane, and it's behind that man Lawrence Shanklin, the whole host of subs, our own Andy Halliday on there, Alex Lowry, Barry Mackay back, which will be pleasing, Tagawa, Forrest, Sibbett, Grant, Neuenhoff as well, the new signing. So decent team for you, Mark.
Of course. I think when you just look at the front, what for Hearts, you know, you've got Cochrane on that left-hand side, Oda started the season well, Boyce in behind Shanklin, or maybe vice versa at some points, goals in the side. And I even think if Hearts, even if they concede first tonight, I think the fans going along have to understand, you know, how to manage a two-legged tie. You're still in the game because of that Shanklin goal that Daz was talking about. You're still in that tie. You need two goals to reinforce it, of course, the extra time. So I think they're in a good place. They're in a good position. But you need to show the fans right through the off your intentions. The last thing you want to do is go and start being edgy and cagey, and that brilliant atmosphere turns a bit sour quickly, and the players then start getting a wee bit nervy off the back of what's coming through the terraces. You need to go and, you know, make your mark early in the game. I really do think they'll go through it tonight.
Yeah, I don't know if I'd be confident if they lost the first goal. I know they're still at home, and, you know, they've got players on that pitch that can score you goals, of course they have. But I think that if your Hearts, your game plan is certainly, you're the team that gets the first goal and puts opposition under a lot of pressure, and then you can control the game from there, because you've still, even if it goes to extra time, you still fancy your chances with the extra time at home. But losing a goal, I think it just sends that little bit of nervousness around the stadium, and I think that feeds on to players, and sometimes you rush into things. So for Hearts tonight, I think getting off to a good start, getting the first goal, and then I think they can control the tie from there, and they're certainly get players that can find the back of net.
Andy was saying the young boy Naipan in the middle of the park, 16 years old, said he was head and shoulders above anybody in the pitch. Said
not saying I'm looking forward to watching the second half when I go home tonight. So
on the recliner.
On the recliner.
How important is, you know, could Lawrence Shanklin be? We spoke about it last week, you know, popping up with that goal. This was the week that Frankie McAvoy said they've not heard anything about this supposed Saudi interest. Everyone's just waiting for the Lawrence of Arabia headlines, I'm sure.
Roger will love that.
But to have him in there and, you know, able to take those opportunities when they come around.
Well, he's a captain first and foremost. I was looking at the caption there. I agree with Mark a little bit. I don't know if Boyce will play, and he'll play in that number 10. We've seen him play
that seems to be the way it'll be.
Plays that role. He's a captain. He takes that responsibility and handles it very, very well. The one thing, he's improved his game so much since he's gone to Hearts. There's no doubt about that. His link-up play, his movement, he's a clever player. And the one thing he's got in his locker, which, you know, stands him above most players, is he's a terrific finisher.
I was surprised. Daz is right. There's so much more to his game since he went to Hearts. I was surprised that he took on that role. I just always saw Shanklin as a, you know, off the shoulder number nine and behind penalty box striker, good finisher, but there's certainly a lot more to his game. I don't know if he's picked that up when he went abroad and maybe developed his game a bit. Did I hear him say he got asked to play right wing back on one occasion when he was abroad?
In Belgium, I
in
think.
In Belgium, yeah. So maybe he's just had to think his game in a different way, but certainly helped Hearts. It certainly looks a lot better when Shankland drops into that hole. But the big thing is, when he links the play, he gets in the box and he can finish. So if a chance or two comes his way tonight, the Hearts fans will certainly be confident they can tuck it away.
And we might stop going on about it eventually, but of course this is a, you know, European qualifier. UEFA will be watching, so it needs to be Frankie McAvoy up front and centre. He better be the one giving the instructions.
Yeah.
Or wrists will be getting slapped.
Look, the guys there, we've touched on it, they're comfortable with the situation. Hopefully the two of them are together tonight. They've picked the right team, they've picked the right tactics, and they get the result for Hearts and obviously for Scottish teams.
Still bonkers. It's a bonkers situation.
Is it though?
It is.
Or do we make more of it from the outside? Because that's what
I don't think it's that bad.
Because Andy sat in that very chair and said,
doesn't make really much matter. Difference.
Roger quite rightly said, oh, don't tell UEFA that, that nothing's changed since last season.
Who does your half-time team talk? Did you ask him?
That's what I'm saying. It's tonight. You have to say that it's Frankie McAvoy, I think.
No, but you have to say, but what did the wig say?
They just said nothing's really changed from last season in terms of the players on the...
I can't believe he said the wig and you just carried on like you knew he was talking about.
Well, Roger Hanna's not got a wig, does he?
Poor Andy. Come getting on. Slaughtered in here and he's on the bench on the telly.
He can't hear us.
Exactly.
For the hair.
It's his place.
Great lad.
It's the best place for him.
He might come on tonight and just get a powerful header.
The cushion.
Boom. But last season, was it not Andy? It was playing in the hole in the European games. Did he not play a wee bit more advanced in the games at Tynecastle anyway?
Yeah, he did actually. Yeah.
Didn't it go that well, right enough, did it?
Nah, not as much game time this season, that's for sure. So overall, you think Hearts are going to do it?
I think Hearts could do it tonight. Yeah, I'm a bit more worried. I hope that Hibs can hold on to that lead, but I'm a bit more worried about Hibs.
In the 90 or the distance?
I think I might go the distance for Hearts.
No, I think they've got enough there in 90.
Halliday in the penalty shootout, can you imagine?
Oh, Andy would score all day long. I'd bet Andy. I think Andy's
take penalties before you.
Yeah, nice left foot. Calm, composed, good at beat the pundit.
I'm trying to get back in with him. Casey listens to the podcast.
Lovely guy.
That'll stand him in good stead. I'm sure he's beat the pundit record when he steps up to take the penalty. Yeah. Right. How are you doing in this teaser? We're looking for
loads.
No, I might just go rogue here and just start applying my own rules. So the question, thanks to David Nagorbal, well, it's not that I don't appreciate it, David. He says, who are the 10 biggest transfers to move out of Scotland? And it is according to Transfer Market, which is a sort of widely known, obviously, database for transfers, right? But when you give me Hutton and you give me the likes of Craig Gordon, the guy that is number 10 on this list, Transfer Market may well say that it was worth more than Hutton and Craig Gordon. I just don't think it was. I've never heard of this transfer being referred to.
Are you giving us Hutton
as more than that, right? So we'll just fudge it completely, right?
Can I?
No, this is the thing. It's not wrong. Listen to the question mark. According to Transfer Market,
so
it's
Matt, not one in your list.
It's Matt Wilson that's wrong. No, we're working as a team, and he's hiding like he's in a school.
That's because you stole.
No, I'm not going to steal it. I'll do Bassey.
I'm just what I'm saying to you is right. The guy that's 10th on this list.
Yep.
I'll give you Alan Hutton / Craig Gordon. They both say 9 million. I'll give you him instead of this guy.
Right. So that means it's wrong.
No, but it's not according to Transfer Market.
But why would you give us
the question?
I'm listening. Why would you give us it?
I feel like being generous to you.
Who is it?
Giovanni Van Bronckhorst.
8 million he was. 8.5 million.
Hutton was more.
But Transfer Market says it's 13 million euros.
Right, who did you give there?
Bassey.
Bassey.
You want another one?
Correct.
The most obvious one, surely Jota.
Jota, well done. We'll get the rest of the answers and keep building up to the Scottish clubs in Europe next.
Clyde One Super Scoreboard. Listen and watch. Check the Twitter feed at Clyde SSB. Clyde One Super Scoreboard with Col Robert Accident Repair. Recruiting automotive panel technicians now. Visit their website to apply.
There's nothing more enjoyable
walkies
than a long walk with your dog or playtime at home with your cat.
Daisy.
ProPlan pet supplements will make them even more enjoyable. By supporting your dog's mobility for more walks or helping give your cat that healthy skin and shiny soft coat.
Oh, who's a beautiful cat?
Your pets will get more from life with the complimentary pet food range. ProPlan supplements for cats and dogs.
If you've lost money since 2017 on a missold investment in carbon, forestry, SIPs, annuities, car parks, eco homes, crypto, or overseas investments, or if you were not told your investment was high risk, any claims would like to talk to you and check your eligibility for compensation. We'll advise how you can make a claim yourself for free or how we could do it for you. You could be owed money without even knowing it. To find out now, text CLAIM to 66777 or visit anyclaims.co.uk. Any Claims is a trading style of Red Hawk Legal, which is authorised and regulated by the Financial Conduct Authority.
Calling all McCrispy lovers. Your favourite chicken burger has been remixed with delicious smoky bacon, hot and spicy mayo, and a caramelised onion relish. As if you didn't love it enough already. The McCrispy Deluxe. It's your favourite chicken remixed. Available until the 5th of September. Served after 11 a.m. Subject to availability.
What are you good at? Like, really good at? Got something? Right. Now imagine you trained for it, get years of experience, and have a load of happy customers you've done it marvellously for. That's just the start of becoming a tradesperson with Trust a Trader, plus passing their 15-point assessment. So, when you want something doing well, that's a job for the Trust a Trader professionals. Find yours at trustatrader.com.
Ladies and gentlemen, Sky Sports proudly presents the most thrilling tournaments and spectacular sporting events the world has ever known. The electrifying US Open Tennis, the remarkable Ryder Cup, the phenomenal Formula One, the captivating Cricket World Cup, the exhilarating EFL, the wondrous Women's Super League, and the one and only Premier League. All sports for an extra £22 a month. Sky Sports, the greatest show on earth.
Offer ends 25th September. Requires Sky TV. See sky.com for details. Further terms apply.
Amy, on behalf of Transport Scotland, is undertaking essential bridge refurbishments on the M8 eastbound between junctions 25 and 25A. From Friday 18th August until Saturday 30th September, a 24-hour contraflow and 40 mph speed limit will be in place. There will be a total closure between junctions 24 and 26 of the M8 westbound from 8 p.m. on Friday 18th until 6 a.m. on Saturday 19th August, and eastbound between junctions 27 and 24 from 8 p.m. on Sunday 20th until 6 a.m. on Monday 21st August. Sign diversions will be in place. For more information, visit swtrunkroads.scot.
Anything else?
Anything? Well, I am looking for the perfect date.
I meant any sauces.
Oh, barbecue.
Add a little bit of sauce to your life. Visit scotsgodating.com.
Make your bingo go with a bang at takeabreakbingo.co.uk. Right now, new players who register and spend £10 can get a £50 scratch room bingo bonus. Lovely stuff. With an offer this good, why don't you swing by takeabreakbingo.co.uk today? Over 18s only, offer ends October 31st. Two times wagering within 2 weeks required. T's and C's apply. BeGambleAware.org.
Number one for football in Glasgow and the West. 0141 951 1025. Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Gordon and Mark Wilson are here. If you're watching the live stream, my apologies. Usually I think there's like a screen that goes up during the break and you don't see us during the break. I don't think that happened this time. And Gordon Dale thought we were winding him up, so he was being silly in the studio, as you would expect. But genuinely, everybody could see that.
No, he wonders why he never gets invited on the telly.
Put it this way.
Like you, Gordon.
Put it this way.
That's why.
I've just had a text from my mum, and all it is five laughing emojis. So I've got a funny feeling people could see you during that break.
I can, if they did, I could only apologise. Ah, I thought you were kidding on.
No, I don't know what happened anyway. Let's bring in Bobby, who's a Hibs fan. Bobby, are you confident? How are you feeling tonight?
Do you know what? I think it's going to be really, really tough. I think we rode our luck a week ago. I thought we got a great result at the end. Maybe flattered us a wee bit, but we were pretty ruthless. in getting the three goals. I think, you know, Hibs have been. You know, I was on a couple of weeks ago, and it was you were obviously dissecting our loss in Andorra, and I was like, look, it's fine.
Oh, I remember it, yeah.
And it was, but we've been pretty disappointing in the league. Apart from the Swiss performance, you know, it's, I don't know. I suppose it depends on which Hibs team turns up tonight. I hope it's the one that turned up last Thursday. I thought the Dutch forward, I thought he was really good last week, and Adam Lafondre, who obviously isn't starting tonight, I think I've been surprisingly impressed with him. You know, I think that for someone of his age, you kind of wonder what you're getting. I noticed that tonight we're starting with both Juhan and Martin Boyle. Mm-hmm. I hope Boyle's fit. I think that's one of the things that when we are really good at attacking with speed. So hopefully we can use that to exploit it. You know, it's going to be tough. I think it's going to be tough for Hearts as well.
Well, here's the thing. Here's the thing, Bobby. I don't know if you want to hear this, but obviously Hibs are winning 3-1. Hearts are losing 2-1 going into these. And these two, Wilson and DL next to me, reckon that Hearts have got a better chance of going through. Is that a wild prediction from them, or is that Hibs' unpredictability in a nutshell?
I'm actually quite. If Gordon Dale's predicting it's going to be hard for Hibs,
you're happy.
There's a fair chance. There's a fair chance we'll do okay.
Well, I'll go on the evidence that I've been at your last two league games, and you've admitted that.
No, that's not the point, though. Three. How did we get to a scenario? Because I don't think you're alone. I'm not ridiculing you completely. But how did we get to the scenario where a 2-1 deficit is better than a 3-1 advantage? This reminds me of you saying it's easier to play against 11 men than 10.
Well, I meant it's harder to break down 10 men than 11. I'll rephrase that one. I just think that I'm looking at Hibs at the back. Defensively, it's early in the season. They've no points. I totally agree with, is it Bobby? I thought last Thursday night, his spells, especially Joe Newell, I thought he was excellent, played very well in the game, but also looked like they could concede goals at Easter Road. They're away from home. I just feel that if that team gets the first goal tonight, Hibs are in trouble.
The incentive's massive, Bobby, isn't it? That Aston Villa, the John McGinn derby.
Do you know what? I do kind of agree with like what you're all saying about how did 3-1 become not as good as 2-1, but you know, since they've taken away goals, it's kind of changed the dynamics. And one goal for Hearts tonight, and it's level, and then you've got, if they get that goal early, they've got 80 minutes, you know, to Rosenberg are a very good team, I think. Maybe not the team that they were, but still a good standard. Whereas, like, we lose an early goal and suddenly it's, yeah, we've still got a lead, but then we've got 80 minutes to defend against a, you know, I thought that the Swiss team were good last week. I wasn't.
Well, I'll tell you what.
I fancy Hibs tonight.
Rosenborg have scored and it does stand. I thought there was a bit of debate over that. That is a disastrous start for Hearts. Bobby might not be too concerned with his Hibs hat on, but Hearts 0, Rosenborg 1 with only 4 minutes gone, and that is a bitter blow because that is obviously 3-1 on aggregate. How are you two feeling about your predictions?
Well, I did say Rosenborg scored, Hearts are still in it. I tell you the most disappointing thing about that is it's an outstanding save from the initial cross and header, an outstanding save, but it gets another bite at the cherry to swivel and then volley it, and Clark almost saves that one. Oh, disastrous start for Hearts.
Yeah, Bobby, there we are. So now, maybe Hibs are favourites to go through out of the two teams now.
I had to mute the phone there for a minute.
To laugh.
I think Mark's actually got a point. Do you know what? See, if you'd lost 2-1 and then lost an away goal like 3-4 years ago, tie's pretty much over. Do you know, you needn't score three. Whereas actually losing a goal, it doesn't really change. Yeah, they need to score. They need to score two now to level it, you know, rather than,
yeah, I mean, Gordon, what was it, keep them coming, what was your favourite old phrase? If you're going to concede early. Early, but I mean that's brutal, that isn't it, Gordon? That's a terrible start for everything that we said about Tynecastle and get it rocking and start fast and all that sort of stuff, and plus, even and do you know what, because the patience thing, what?
They could lose two here.
Yeah, Rosenborg are in again and they drag it wide. Even the patience thing goes out the window a bit. You know, it's not like it's nil-nil and you're feeling your way in and think, okay, we only need that one to level it up.
And what it's certainly done for the, Rosenborg is the confidence. As Mark rightly said, we're sitting here thinking, this could even get worse now. It could be two. And he's just dragged it by the post. Hearts look like they've been shaken with that goal. They're a bit all over the place. They've got to get a bit of composure and try and get... They're still in this tie,
I think they need Andy Halliday on, quite frankly.
Yeah, get the wig on. That's a body blow for them.
Any man who's got eight on Beat the Pundit's got the composure for this stage, surely.
Oh, yeah.
Come on, a calm head. Certainly. Well, thank you, Bobby. Enjoy your night if you can. And hopefully we'll hear from you Hibs and Hearts fans tomorrow, however this plays out. But that is not a good start for Hearts at all. And Mark, initially as well, because it comes from the set piece, the cross, saved by Xander Clark and then forced home in the rebound. It's a really daft or sloppy foul from Frankie Kent, the new signing as well. There's a ball sort of bouncing up waist high. Kind of gets it all wrong, kicks the Rosenborg player, gives the free kick away.
Doesn't really need to go for it, does he? It's the ball that's bouncing out towards the touchline. He mistimes it. He catches the boy in the hip. And you put yourself immediately under pressure. When you've seen the delivery coming in there, you must have studied the boy that's put it in the box, how good he is at set pieces if he's crossing a ball like that. So, absolutely disastrous. But as Bobby was saying there, the away goal rule now abolished. Hearts know they have to score two. They knew they had to score two at the start to go through. But now they still need to score two to keep it alive.
I'll tell you what, it's a real low moment for your punditry careers here. I've just had a message from Hugh Keevans to say, how's their predictions looking? From the guy who can't predict what...
Evening, Hugh.
Yeah. I was going to say.
Back to normal service on Saturday.
Yeah.
You can't predict the...
You can't argue with Mr. Keevans. He's got it spot on. You've got to take the criticism.
Anyway, Hearts looking to try and get back in this one and in the tie. It's a possible mark in terms of the clock, certainly. And in fact, huge chance. Oh, it's hit the post. What a glorious effort that was.
I was wanting that to go in for Keevans.
And what's even more bizarre is Stephen Kingsley then fires one towards goal, which Frankie Kent decides to clear.
Divert away. Yeah, what an opportunity, actually. Hearts kept that alive quite well. The ball's kind of bouncing about in that box. But whoever it is, a wee bit of composure, then... off the inside of the post, across the goalkeeper, off the inside of the post.
What about the rebound though? I think Kingsley's effort's looking not bad. And
Shankland does well there to play Oda in.
Kent clears it.
Kingsley does catch it well. Oh, by the way, it's gone in target.
And he thinks he's defending up the other end.
I've got to. I would have probably tried to flick that. I think that he's.
You're going to have to get it right though. Anyway, yeah. Right, quickly. On your teaser, looking for 1, 2, 3, 4 more of the most expensive transfers out of Scotland according to Transfer Market.
I've got one. Van Dijk.
Did you get that off my list?
Well, by any chance, near my shoulder?
Go on then.
Quick.
Did we say Craig Gordon?
Oh, well, no, he's not on it.
Is he not on it?
Well, you can have him. You can have him or Hutton as your number 10, right?
What did Edward go for?
Well done.
Edward, yeah.
Yeah.
How many do we need?
Two.
Struggling.
Both ex-Celtic. One currently in English Premier League. One probably a teammate of yours, maybe, Mark? No, maybe not.
Wanyama?
Yes.
Oh, well done.
Did you overlap with him?
Yes, I did. Big Vic, I mean.
Next one, quick.
Oh, I'm struggling now.
Currently English Premier League with Brentford.
Ayer.
No,
how much did Ayer go for?
13 million, I think.
Did he? What a deal that is.
Good player, Christopher Ayer. Thank you. Celtic. Okay, Hearts are behind. We wish them and Hibs the best. We'll see how it goes and we will react to it tomorrow. And it will be on to the League Cup group stages, League Cup knockout games as well. We look forward to it. Thanks for joining us. We will be back. Simon Donnelly and Hugh Keevans, I think, tomorrow is indeed. And remember, you can watch back, listen.